I'd like to introduce our second main speaker of the day, Fiona Macaulay. Fiona is from the Bristol Crisis Service for Women and has also worked in partnership with the Norah Fry Centre. And she carried out the first UK-wide research project looking at people with self-injury who've got learning disabilities. Since 2012, her role has been to coordinate TESS, the National Text and Email Support Service for young women affected by self-injury, and to deliver training to organisations on this topic. So please welcome Fiona Macaulay.
I'm actually from an organisation called Self Injury Support that used to be called the Bristol Crisis Service for Women. It seems down in Bristol there's a bit of a fashion for organisational name changes at the moment. We are a national organisation that's been working around the issue of self-injury for approximately 30 years now, and we're one of the longest running organisations that's been looking at this issue. And as I'm sure you can imagine, we've seen some real changes in how the issue is known and understood and supported as well in that time. The Norah Fry Research Centre is now actually called the Norah Fry Centre for Disability Studies as well. So I don't know why this has all happened at a very similar time, but it has. So if you want to do further kind of research into looking into the work of our organisations, use those two names. What I want to do today is to talk about the Hidden Pain Project, which was the project that we did in partnership with the Norah Fry Research Centre. And I worked with Dr. Pauline Heslop on that particular project. The reason we did that piece of work is around 2005, I think self-injury as an issue was becoming much more well known. It was being talked about in the media a lot more, and was just generally in just known as an issue in lots of different services, and was being discussed more widely, really. And we were getting more contact from learning disability organisations saying, you know, what information is there out there for people with learning disabilities who self-injure? How can we support people better? And at that time, we had some accessible information, but nothing else. So we were quite limited in what we could offer to people. Around that time, similarly, the Norah Fry Research Centre were looking at the mental health needs of people with learning disabilities. And in that project, they were noticing a lot of people who were using self-injury, and the way that it was being understood and the way that it was being supported varied enormously. There was a real inconsistency across lots of services. So they were really noticing that this was a piece of work that needed to be done. There was also a national inquiry into young people and self-harm around that time, again highlighting the need for more specialist research looking at people with learning disabilities who self-injure. So it felt all very, very timely around then to actually put in a bid in partnership with the Norah Fry Research Centre to do this piece of work. And we were lucky enough to be given that funding and to be able to carry it out. So thinking about what we knew around that time is that for people without learning disabilities, there was a lot of research that already existed that considered the views of people themselves about their self-injury. You know, we're very much of the thinking that people know their lives, they know their experiences, they know their feelings, they know the functions of their self-injury. So, you know, that's a perspective that we really wanted to hear. And for people without learning disabilities, lots of that research already existed. We know that self-injury has a clear function and is often used in response to dealing with quite intense emotional distress. And the interventions that are used is often about advocating talking therapies, trying to think of other or other coping strategies that can be put in place, really, instead of using that self-injury. Around the time, however, the way that it was viewed for people with learning disabilities was very different, considering it was the same issue. So there's little or no research considering the views of people with learning disabilities themselves. The self-injury was often understood within a biological framework, so it was often linked to that person's learning disability or maybe a genetically predetermined syndrome, whatever it was that particular person had. And it often came under the umbrella term of challenging behaviour. And we found that people were quite reluctant to use the term self-injury or self-harm in the same way that they do for people without learning disabilities. And we thought there was an interesting element to do with that. And in terms of interventions used for people with learning disabilities, it was often things like medication was used or behaviour modification, trying to change people's behaviour. So these were things that we really wanted to look at in quite a lot more detail. So thinking about the aims of our research project, the main aim really was to find out the views and experiences of people with learning disabilities. We wanted to ask them directly what their self-injury meant for them. We also wanted to interview their carers and family members and their supporters if we had permission from the person with learning disabilities to do so. We also wanted to interview people, the professionals with whom they were involved, again, only with the person's permission. And then we wanted to identify ideas and then produce resources for training and policy development, and really to spread the word about the project as much as we possibly could. So in terms of how we recruited research participants, we advertised the project nationally. We really thought about how we could get the word out to people with learning disabilities by really contacting as many mental health, learning disabilities, self-injury organisations as we possibly could, and spreading the word as much as possible to try and get people with learning disabilities who were interested to contact us to think about taking part. We weren't in the business of defining who did and didn't have a learning disability. So basically, if people either were using, had used, or were eligible to use learning disability services, then they were able to take part in the research. We wanted people who were 14 and over, had either self-injured in the past or were currently self-injuring. And that was something that we had a clear definition for, and I'll go through that in just a moment. What was important, that the person was able to relate their experiences to us using their usual means of communication. And whatever that was, we were happy to adapt whatever we needed to do to find out and in order to be able to communicate with people who wanted to take part. The minimum requirement was that they were able to say yes or no, and also that they were able to clearly show us that they wanted to stop the research if for whatever reason they felt they needed to. People were excluded from the research if they weren't able to understand clearly what the research was all about. So we had contact from a range of different services, people saying, actually, yes, I work with someone, they self-injure, they're quite interested in the project. So what we would do, myself and my colleague Pauline, would actually go and offer a preliminary visit. And there were a number of different functions to these visits. The first one was to really explain what the research project was about. And sometimes that was quite difficult because people thought it was either therapy or support in some way. And actually what we had to try and convey was actually, researchers, we just really wanted to hear their story and hear what their self-injury was all about. And I think for some people that was quite an alien concept because it was the first time that they'd been asked to actually talk about their self-injury in any depth or to find out what their views and experiences were about. So that took a bit of kind of clarification. Yes, we just wanted to sit and talk to them and hear what their self-injury and their story was. It was also to ensure their understanding, to get to know them a little bit, especially just for them to get to know us as well, because we were going to show up, expect people to talk quite openly about very personal aspects of their lives. You know, we had to ensure that people felt comfortable with us, they felt at ease in our company, and we did some nice things where people would go for a walk on the beach or take people to a cafe for a cup of tea or something, just to realise that, you know, it wasn't going to be this onerous, difficult situation that they were finding themselves in. We also wanted to find out their preferences for the interview, where they wanted it to take place, whether they wanted any support workers to be there or not. And we also then had to get permissions from local authorities to actually be doing the research in that area. We had quite a lot of kind of red tape in that respect to make sure that we had permissions from local authorities to do that piece of work. Then what we would do is actually get the written consent from them that they wanted to take part, and then the written consent that they actually didn't mind us contacting their families or maybe their professionals as well to find out, you know, their views as well. We also wanted to let them know about post-interview support. Again, self-injury is often linked to difficult circumstances, I'm sure you know that through the work that you do. And for some, it was the first time they'd ever spoken about it. So we weren't going to just show up, expect them to pour their heart out to us, tell us all about their life and their difficult circumstances, and then just leave them. We did actually ensure that we had post-interview support set up. And what we actually did was to contact counsellors in that person's area who had experience of supporting people with learning disabilities, and then kind of have them ready and waiting for a call from that person or from that service saying, yes, we would like to follow up and offer this person support. And that was something that we paid for as part of the project. So thinking about our definition of self-injury, we use the definition, a wide range of things that people do to themselves in a deliberate and usually hidden way, which are damaging. And within this project, we recognise the specific typographies of self-injury that are more commonly presenting in people with learning disabilities. And that's things like self-scratching, head-banging, biting, those kind of things. And some of you might come across those in your work. Things like inserting objects and eye poking as well, all those kind of things that maybe are more commonly seen in people with learning disabilities. So in terms of the research participants, we actually recruited 25 people with learning disabilities from all over the UK. And we did a total of 104 visits. And that's because often people weren't kind of able to sit down and do all of the research questions in one go. And actually, I think it would have been unethical of us to even try and do that because we were asking so many different things. So what we would often do is go back a number of times, and people had different lengths of time that they were able to talk for. There was one woman who I interviewed, and we did it in 10-minute slots. I would go back about every month and do a 10-minute slot with this particular woman. And after 10 minutes, she'd say, I don't want to do any more, this is too difficult. And then I would come back the next month and we would start again. And it was whatever people were comfortable with doing. It was predominantly women, 19 women of the 25. 19 of the 25 were women, 6 were men. A real range of ages, between 14 and 65, and a range of types of self-injury as well. And a range of living circumstances as well. So some were living at home with families, right through to supported living, residential settings, and some people were in secure units as well. We then, with their permission, asked if we could speak to either family members or professionals with whom they were linked. It's quite interesting that it seems that people didn't actually want us speaking to their families. You know, only 7 of the 25 gave us permission to do that, whereas 21 actually gave us permission to talk to professionals with whom they were linked. The non-linked family members and professionals were people who had heard about the research and were interested in giving a contribution to the research, but actually weren't linked to any of the people with learning disabilities that we were interviewing. So this is just a table of the type of injuries that people were carrying out in the study. And as you can see there, that the percentages don't add up to 100%, and that's because on most of the time people had more than one method of self-injury. On average, people had 3 methods, and they often had a preferred method, but sometimes weren't able to use that preferred method, so would kind of go to their second and third preferred methods. But you can see that there's a real range of different things that you can do. And through our experience of working with self-injury, we know that the more restricted the settings are, it tends to be that the self-injury intensifies. Okay. And this was a table showing the approximate age when self-injury started. And this was because either people could remember when they started self-injuring, or family members were able to remember when the first time that it happened. And this table absolutely mirrors the same as people without learning disabilities. Those ages are exactly the same. And also just to bear in mind that self-injury is not something that just starts in younger years. It happens less frequently, but it can happen that people start self-injuring later on in their lives. And that happened with a few of the people that we interviewed, that had actually led quite content, happy lives until they were, you know, a bit older. And then something had happened, they'd moved settings, and suddenly they'd started self-injuring in those settings because they were finding it very difficult to deal with. And this was just the frequency of self-injury at the time of the study. So for some of the people, it was still very much a daily feature in their lives. And for others, it was less frequent, and sometimes it was more occasional and something that happened, something that happened sometimes. I think also to bear in mind that even if people aren't self-injuring, often people might be having the urge to self-injure and might be fighting that battle quite a lot as well. I think sometimes people focus on just the self-injury, whether it's happening or not, but that's something that we hear a great deal, is people, you know, battling with those urges. So in terms of what people said about why they self-injure, what people did, they were able to talk to us about the circumstances that would lead up to self-injury. They would talk about the feelings before they self-injured, and also the particular functions that self-injury serves as well. And thinking about the circumstances that would lead to self-injury, it was quite interesting that there were a number of different factors. There were external factors for people, and that was about things that were going on around the person. There were interpersonal factors, and that was about dealings with people around that individual. But there are a number of internal factors as well, and that was about the person themselves, irrespective of where they were or who they were with at the time. And I just want to go through that in a bit more detail. So the first external factor was being in disempowering circumstances. And these kind of things came up time and time again in people's accounts and people's stories. So people not feeling listened to. I cannot say how much that came up with people saying that that was a circumstance that, that led them to self-injure. There were circumstances where people were being told off, or maybe being, were being told what to do, or maybe there were demands placed upon people, but actually they weren't given enough support with which to carry out those demands. People spoke about being treated like a child quite frequently, and people talking about you, and that was often in reference to professionals who were talking about individuals without actually involving that person. Another external factor was a lack of control within people's living environments. And if I think about my own life and where I live and who I live with, are some of the most important decisions that have a really big impact on my well-being. And for people with learning disabilities, it felt like they weren't given that choice of where they lived and who they were living with in the same way. And it was interesting to hear the impact of other residents on people. Just things like too much noise. So people wanting to go to, or have a quiet place in their house that they could go to, but not necessarily wanting to go to their bedroom and be on their own, wanting to be in a more social area, but not being able to do that. It might be there was just too much going on, places were too hectic, and actually they wanted that quieter space. For others, it was something like a lack of autonomy. I remember someone saying, I don't get hungry first thing in the morning. I like to eat my breakfast a bit later, but actually where she was living, the breakfast things were packed away by about 9:30. So she had to then wait until lunchtime until she could actually get something to eat. And for other people, it was about things like just being quite bored, not being stimulated, not having things to do. And one particular person said that they used to self-injure as a response to the fact they couldn't get out and do things. And thinking about interpersonal factors, being bullied was something that people spoke about a great deal as a circumstance that led to self-injury. So being physically bullied, being picked on or being called names, being made fun of or being laughed at, just having that in their lives had a really big effect on how they felt about themselves, and then that would often bring the onset of quite low feelings that would lead them on to self-injure. And we know through other work that the effects of bullying can be really long-lasting, and especially in terms of how a person feels about themselves. The other interpersonal factor that people spoke about was the impact of arguments. And I think that was either arguments within living environments or it was overhearing other arguments taking place. And that was often true if the arguments themselves were about them and actually they could hear the impact on them on maybe the people in their lives. So that happened quite a lot in terms of family members. So a younger person could hear possibly their parents arguing about them and them being aware of it, and that, you know, leading them to feeling quite low about how they felt. And then thinking about internal factors, a lot of people had a lot of physical health issues alongside their learning disabilities, which again played a negative part in their life quite a lot. A lot of people had physical illnesses alongside their learning disabilities with which were quite difficult to deal with on a daily basis. One person said, oh, I just saw myself as a person covered in sores and I just hate myself. So feeling very different to other people, having that effect of that physical illness on their self-worth and their well-being. A lot of people had mobility impairments, were having to rely on supporters or other people to actually go out and do things. And then other people spoke about just being quite tired or quite exhausted, and that might be something to do with things like the side effects of particular medications that people were taking. The other internal factor, which I think is really relevant to today, was the memories of difficult past experiences in people's lives. Before we even started this research, we knew that it was likely that some quite negative experiences in people's lives would come up. And knowing the link between self-injury and abusive pasts was something that we were probably, we knew that we were likely to hear to some degree. We were quite staggered that actually 10 of the 25 had reported cases of serious abuse against them. 7 of those had actually been sexual abuse. 9 of the 25 had suffered significant bereavements in their lives with which they hadn't had appropriate support. And what was really interesting is that professionals and carers weren't always aware either of those either about those experiences. Sometimes when people were moving from place to place, their records or their histories weren't present or weren't particularly thorough in what that person had been through. So it was a real factor in that people on a day-to-day basis were supporting someone whose past was having a really big impact on their day-to-day well-being, but they weren't aware of that. And I think that can be quite difficult for supporters when actually they're doing everything they can to support someone and working through lots of strategies with someone, and still they're self-injuring. Because actually, you know, it can leave workers quite demoralised and feeling quite negative about the fact that the person has gone back to the self-injury when they've been trying so hard. But actually, those past experiences had a really big impact on those individuals. So I hope you can take that away with you a little bit today. So in terms of the feelings that a person has before they self-injure, all those circumstances that I just mentioned would lead on to the development of quite intense feelings. And all of the people in the study were able to identify feelings they experienced before self-injuring. And the most commonly reported feelings leading directly to self-injury were either feeling angry, feeling frustrated or feeling wound up, feeling sad, depressed or low, or feeling upset. And you can hear from that terminology that the emotional literacy and the emotional understanding of the people that we interviewed was quite limited. So they're quite using quite basic emotional terms. For some, they would actually deal with those emotions, they would bottle them up and try and not self-injure. Or others would actually try and kind of create a personal threshold that they would try and get to a particular point before they self-injured, but often they would go on and do that. And then thinking about what people spoke about afterwards, again, the language is quite basic, but people often had a mixture of emotions after they'd done it. The most commonly reported feelings after self-injury were feeling mixed, so feeling better and worse at the same time. Some people just felt bad or worse. Some people just felt better in some way. Some people felt upset or sad that they actually got to that particular point. Some felt calmer, but then some felt annoyed or ashamed that they'd actually done that. And then thinking about what the functions or meanings of self-injury were for people. for most, it was an expression of that emotional pain that they were feeling. And people often talk about kind of a mixture of emotions or a big kind of build-up of emotions that they speak about. And it's a way of getting that emotional pain out. But it's also a way of communicating how people are feeling. As I mentioned, a lot of people felt that they weren't listened to or they felt unheard. For some, actually talking about feelings was very difficult, or just verbal communication was very difficult in order to have those conversations. Other functions were that it was linked to those difficult experiences that people had been through in the past. Some people spoke about wanting control, having something that was there, something that they could control for themselves. They could control when it started, when it finished, how they did it. And in situations and environments where control is more limited, those very small aspects of control can be very meaningful for people. Other people spoke about it feeling like a release of that build-up of emotions, or just a way that they coped with how they felt. Other people spoke about it being a habit or an addiction. Sometimes that word addiction comes into self-injury quite a lot, that people feel they feel like they're actually addicted to it and find it very difficult to stop. Something that we were quite surprised about in this research was the level of suicidal thoughts. As an organisation, we're often trying to separate self-injury and suicide. Self-injury often being a way that people actually deal with very difficult emotions, and suicide being about when people actually can't cope anymore and want to take their own lives. And there are overlaps between the two, but actually in this particular project, suicidal thoughts came up much more than we thought they were going to. Half of the participants had thought about suicide. Some had either inconsistent or active suicidal thoughts, but several had actually attempted to kill themselves, three so seriously that they had required resuscitation. And I think that's because those levels of distress just weren't being recognised along the way. So just some quotes from people. One person said, "I feel good and bad. It depends what I did, but it made me feel better. It made me feel more alive. It made me feel better, basically." And the interviewer said, "So that's the good bit. It makes you feel more alive. It makes you feel better. What's the bad bit?" And they said, "In some ways, I wish I didn't do it." And that's quite common, again, that kind of that battle between wanting to do it and not wanting to do it. Someone else said, "All I can remember is the relief of the pain inside. So again, that's all I can say. So the pain that you were feeling inside, yeah, it made it go away. Better, yeah. It made it better for a while." And there's that cycle of those emotions building up again and again. And that time span can be very different for different people, depending on what's going on and how frequently they self-injure. So thinking about support and what support you can offer, the importance of communication was massive. We think about how unheard people felt in the project. And so the importance of communication and listening to people was absolutely massive. Three quarters of the people with learning disabilities who self-injured wanted someone to talk with and someone to listen to them. You know, it's really basic stuff that can really have a big impact on this issue. And this included people with limited speech, and we found that actually people with more limited communication really valued the additional effort that people put in to try and get them to be able to have those conversations with them. Some wanted to talk before they self-injured. They could feel that urge rising and they wanted to talk beforehand. Other people knew that felt quite unstoppable, so they wanted to talk after the event. But what we found is that some people would actually find themselves in front of a support worker and they would often want to be prompted or be given permission to talk about self-injury. In some places, we've found that staff aren't allowed to talk about it with people. And I don't know, you know, in the different settings that you work, but people with learning disabilities found that quite baffling, that they didn't understand why people wouldn't talk about this issue that was quite a key thing in their lives. So in terms of messages from people with learning disabilities for support workers, was to try and learn new strategies for distraction. We found that people actually were trying and using many different methods on their own to try and not get to the point where they would self-injure. We were staggered by how many personal strategies people had to try and not self-injure. So that's a really good starting point to try and see what people are doing for themselves already. As I mentioned, to think about communication and set aside time in order to do that. People also wanted help to understand their emotions. Their emotions were very confusing, but very strong. So that work in terms of emotional literacy, to try and break down what emotions felt, and how people could learn to express those emotions in other and more safe ways. People also spoke about wanting access to support when they needed it rather than it being at an allotted time. So having that open door policy, I know, is very difficult in a practical day-to-day aspect, but also to recognise just how valuable it is for people when they do want to be able to access support. And then the last thing was recognising the importance of peer support as well. People often thought they were the only people who self-injured. They didn't realise that actually it was a quite common issue that people use to deal with their emotional distress. So, you know, to recognise that, you know, there are other people out there, and maybe to try and set up, you know, some kind of peer support. So just, I'm going to show you a clip from a DVD that we produced in just a moment, but just some conclusions before we get to that. Just that self-injury is a very individual affair. It's good to have these summations, but also to work with individuals. It's largely used in response to difficult circumstances and emotions, and there was a lot of hidden distress in the people that we spoke to. For a lot of people, understanding and dealing with difficult feelings can be quite problematic, not understanding what it is that they're actually going through. To think about self-injury when it's not happening. You know, what's going on for the person when they're actually not self-injuring? What's different from when they are self-injuring? And the mixture of emotions that self-injury can make people feel better and worse. As I just mentioned, people may already be taking action to limit or stop their own self-injury, so to think about that. And there was often a difference between what people with learning disabilities thought was helpful support in relation to stopping their self-injury and what others provided with them. So it's about professionals and individuals working together rather than maybe professionals kind of suggesting what might work best. And that's really about working with a person, understanding what's most helpful for them. And then the last point is just helping a person change their ways of thinking can be as effective as helping them change their ways of being. And that's really because self-injury is something you can't necessarily stop overnight. It's a really long and complex issue. But actually, if you can enable someone and support someone to understand it a little bit better, then hopefully it will reduce in its frequency and its intensity, and that will kind of work better for everybody. What I want to do now is just show you a clip. We made a DVD in response to this piece of work, and it's some stories from the research. This one's about 7 minutes long, I think. So you'll have an idea of what the interviews felt like and the kind of things that people spoke about.
Sarah's story.
My name is Sarah. I'm 24 years old. I live in a supported living house. I live with four other people, but there's two people that are always arguing, and I really don't like the shouting. It makes me upset.
And what happens when you're upset? What do you do?
I go in my room, and certain things happen to me.
What do you mean by certain things?
I hurt myself.
When did you start hurting yourself, Sarah?
When I was 13. And I live in this children's home. And there was one member of staff there. And he was always shouting, and it made me feel very scared and vulnerable.
And how long did you hurt yourself for?
for a while, and then it stopped. But then abuse happened to me, and I started again, and this time it was much worse.
Did anyone know that you hurt yourself?
No, nobody knew. I did it when I was on my own. And nobody could see me. I was very frightened.
What were you frightened of?
I was frightened of what everybody would think of me.
What did you think they would do?
I think that they would shout at me even more.
Do you know why you hurt yourself, Sarah?
Because of all the things that have happened to me in the past. I get upset about how it makes me feel.
So just to finish, just to make some recommendations, just to acknowledge self-injury as an issue in its own right. You know, it's an issue that needs to be supported and understood in its own right, not just necessarily thought about as being part of something else. So addressing self-injury in people with learning disabilities just as it is across the board. Striving to create conditions in which people can be in control as much as possible. And as I mentioned, people didn't really understand their emotions too well, so it's about working with people to try and increase that emotional literacy. In terms of distractions and trying people who were having those urges to self-injure, to think about what distractions people were already using and to build on those and then to work to make suggestions as well. And to work with those individuals in a very person-centred and creative way as well, because people, you know, are very different. The kind of things they're going to, the kind of strategies they're going to use are going to vary enormously. So it's about trying lots of different and varied approaches and seeing which ones feel most appropriate for that particular individual. Trying to be consistent across the board with all staff members, I'm sure. That's something that, you know, comes up a great deal. Putting systems in place for people to explore past experiences, whatever that may be. I don't know what different support settings you have, what support you have available in your services, but thinking about giving people the opportunity to talk about those past experiences. And yes, that might mean increased distress, but then hopefully that legacy of those past experiences won't be so prevalent for people on a day-to-day basis. As I mentioned, considering peer support for people and just practice listening skills. You know, think about how you're communicating with people and the language that you're using around self-injury. There's often labels of it being right or wrong for people, but actually for a lot of people it's a really effective self-managing way of dealing with their emotional distress. So actually for those people, how, you know, it doesn't feel wrong to them, it can often feel very right. So it's about thinking about unpicking that and working with them a little bit.